I hope you haven't gotten over that. Oh, what the Lord has done for us to save us. I hope that the more you understand, the more amazed you are. We all be shocked that Holy God would love us, and that Jesus would come in this world to die for us that we might be saved. It ought to shock us. It really, we should live with an awe and amazement at the fact that eternal Holy God would love us.
Yes, amen.
The Bible tells us that if we've been saved, that we're saved because the Lord has called us.
Yes.
God deals with our heart. He convicts us. And the Lord has issued His invitation of salvation to us. And so we are responding to the Lord and to His grace, His invitation of grace, when we trust Christ to be our Savior and Lord. So the Lord has called us. He has called us to salvation. You and I could not be saved if it had not been for the fact that God came after us.
Amen.
And then we, by faith, we choose to repent of our sin. Put our trust in Christ as our Savior. That's all an act of the grace of God. God has saved us by grace. For by grace He is saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It's the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. And so the Lord has invited us. He has invited us to salvation. He has invited us into His forgiveness. He has invited us to be recipients of eternal life. And we respond through the grace of the Lord, and we have received Christ as our Savior. This invitation that the Lord has given unto you and unto me is not a mere invitation to a better life. This invitation that the Lord has given to us is not a call to a higher standard of morality. This invitation that He's given unto us is not a call to church membership. It's not. It's a call to be a disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ. We are called to be His followers. The call of salvation is the call to discipleship. And we've been looking at that these last few weeks, and we're going to continue in that theme this morning. We've seen thus far that the call of salvation is a call of conversion. Conversion of discipleship that we saw in the Great Commission text, that Jesus told us to go on the basis of His authority, go into all the world and make disciples. Make disciples. If you're looking at a King James text, you see the word there, teach. Teach all nations. And that word teach is actually the verb form of the Greek word translated disciple. Make disciples. You go and you make disciples. Mathetes is the word for disciple. And the word that Jesus uses there in the Great Commission is mathetesate. Go and make disciples. And so as we share the gospel, those who are converted to Christ are now disciples. We are born into a life of being a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so we saw, first of all, the conversion of discipleship. The Scripture says that we have been raised with Jesus.
Amen.
Raised with Him to walk in newness of life. And so salvation is a life with Jesus through the power of His resurrection.
Amen.
And we live a brand new life with the Lord as His saved people. And then last week we saw the connection of discipleship, and that is connection with Christ. Salvation is a call into a relationship with the Lord. It's relational. Salvation is a relationship with Jesus. And it's not just a relationship with Jesus in which we find Him to be our best friend. It's not just a warm-hearted or the greatest of all warm-hearted relationships. Although it certainly is that. All the blessings that come to us as those who are in relationship with the Lord. The peace and the joy and the contentment, the fulfillment, the purpose, all those realities that we know in that relationship. But it is indeed a relationship where we love the Lord and we know of His love for us, and we have this close walk and relationship with Him. But But it is a relationship in which Jesus Christ relates to us as our sovereign Lord.
Amen.
And we relate to Him as His reverent servants. It's that relationship that we have through the saving work of God as disciples of the Lord Jesus. And we saw the invitation of that relationship last week as we looked at our text in Matthew chapter 11, where we saw that Jesus had come unto me. And in that passage, just a few words later, after talking about coming unto Him, He says, take my yoke upon you. That's being employed for work.
Amen.
In this relationship with Jesus, we are His working disciples. We work in the work of the kingdom of God. We give ourselves over to the service of the Lord. And He says, and learn of me. In other words, we are the Lord's students. That's why that word disciple is so important in all of that, because we are His students, we are His apprentices. We follow Him, we seek to know His teachings, and we follow His example, and we seek to live the life that the Lord would have us to live.
Amen.
And then this morning, as we go in further in this idea of salvation being called to discipleship, I want us to see the cross of discipleship. We've seen the conversion of discipleship and the connection with Jesus that we have in discipleship. And now this morning, let's take a few moments in the context of the Lord's Supper. What a perfect timing all of this is. We see the cross of discipleship. And the passage that we're really focusing in on this morning for a little while is Luke chapter 9, verses 23 through verse 25. Notice what Jesus says here in this passage. Then He said to them all, if anyone, okay, so He's saying there are no exclusions here. This is all inclusive. Anybody who wants to be my disciple, anyone who wants to follow me, no exceptions to the rule. If anyone wants to come with me, he must deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow me. That's everybody who is a real disciple of Jesus Christ. Jesus said, this is applicable to anybody who wants to follow me. There is no way that a person can be my follower if he does not deny himself, commit to daily picking up his cross and following me. Otherwise, there is no real discipleship.
Amen.
It's only phony. Verse 24. For whoever wants to save his life, whoever wants to be rescued from the plight of their sin and the self-destruction of a life contrary to God, whoever wants to save his life will lose it. You try to hang on to your waywardness. You try to hang on to your self-directed life. You try to hang on to life your way. Jesus says you will lose it in your lostness. You will lose it in condemnation. But whoever gives up his life, whoever will lose his life, whoever will deny himself and take up his cross and follow me, whoever loses his life because of me will actually know the salvation. He will save it. What is a man benefited if he gains the whole world and yet loses or forfeits himself? And then in Matthew's parallel passage in Matthew chapter 16, verse 25, he says, what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his soul, his psuche, his being, who he really, really is? You know, Christians in the early centuries would be absolutely appalled at the popular message of Christendom today.
Amen.
They would really be shocked. And it would be such a foreign message to them. To think that there would be those who would have this idea that we come to Jesus to have a happy life. That we come to Jesus to gain wealth. That we come to Jesus so that we'll always be helpful. We come to Jesus for these temporal positives.
Amen.
That's not the idea that the early believers had. That's not the focus that's given to us in the Scripture.
Amen.
You know, one would come to Jesus and say, Jesus, I'm going to follow you. I'll follow you. I'll be your disciple. I'll be your follower. Jesus, hold on here. The foxes have holes. The birds of the air have these nests. You want to follow me? I don't have a place to lay my hand. I don't have a place to lay my hand. And you're going to follow me? Sell the message that is so popular today to the early apostles who would be executed for their faith and the untold numbers of believers who were executed because of being followers of the Lord Jesus. Listen, those early disciples in those early centuries did not come to Jesus so that they could get an advance in their vocation. They didn't come to Jesus so that they could be a little bit happier than what they were. They didn't come to Jesus so they could find a greater level of contentment in their personal life. They didn't come to Jesus so that their marriages would work or so that their family would stop being dysfunctional. They came to Jesus because they knew they were lost in their sins, they were condemned by a holy God, and they were going to hell if they didn't get saved. That's why they came to Jesus. They came to Jesus because they knew that the Lord was worthy of the surrender of their life to Him.
Amen.
They came to Jesus because they knew that it was the right thing to do to spend every day of their life living for the glory of the Lord.
Yes. Amen.
That's why they came to the Lord Jesus. They came to Jesus because they knew that their way of living was a tremendous insult to the holiness of God. And they didn't want to continue in that condition.
Amen.
That's why they came to the Lord Jesus Christ. Now I'm glad to report to you that in that coming we find peace that goes beyond understanding.
Amen.
I'm glad to tell you that in that coming unto the Lord that we find that out of our very innermost being there are artesians of wells that spring up within us. I'm glad to tell you this morning that when we come to the Lord, that we find the Good Shepherd who watches over us and provides for us and protects us. But you don't come to the Lord for those blessings. You come to the Lord because you're a sinner and you need a Savior. And then those blessings are wonderful, wonderful additions to what the Lord does in our heart and life when He saves us from our sin. Salvation. Discipleship involves two crosses. You don't get saved and you don't live as a disciple of Jesus apart from two crosses. There's the cross of Jesus Christ and there's your cross.
Amen.
That's what Jesus says. There's the cross of Christ and it's in that cross that we're saved.
Amen.
There is no redeeming power in my cross. But my cross is to be taken up and borne because I understand the work of Jesus in His cross.
Amen.
And because I have received the efficacy of His cross. And now therefore I live as a cross-bearing disciple of the Lord Jesus if I'm living my days the way the Lord would have me to be living my days.
Yes.
Cross. We follow Him with our own cross on our back, so we don't really follow.
Amen.
What's involved in the cross of the Lord Jesus? And what's involved, therefore, in our cross? If our cross is patterned after the cross of Jesus, and our cross, please don't misunderstand me. I'm not talking about a bearing of our cross to be saved. Our cross doesn't get us saved. Our cross is because we are saved. Our cross is because we are saved and we live as God saved people by bearing the cross. And we have all been called to be cross bearers.
Amen.
Through the grace of the Lord in Jesus Christ. What's involved in this cross? There is a great connection between the cross of Jesus and the cross that you and I would bear. What is this? Well, here in our text we see it. The cross of our Lord, the cross that you and I are to bear as disciples of Jesus, involves repentance from a self-governed living.
Amen.
Now think about Jesus. Jesus did not have to repent. Jesus did not have to repent. We repent to get in harmony with his emptying of himself. We repent in the denial of ourselves, recognizing that we have not lived that way. But Jesus existed the cross. Jesus lived every day of his existence in this world with the cross. Now it culminated with that physical cross at Calvary, but Jesus lived every day of his existence here in this world, bearing his cross spiritually.
Amen.
Jesus lived with that denial of himself and a rejection of a self-directed, self-governed life. John chapter 6 and verse 38, Jesus says this, "For I have come down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me."
Amen.
And then as Jesus was praying in the Garden of Gethsemane, did it not all come to surface in those words of Jesus as he said, "My Father," in Matthew 26, verse 39, "My Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me, yet not as I will, but as you will."
Amen. Amen.
And so he lived with the dynamic of the cross. He lived with it. A relinquishing of himself to the will of the Father. He did not come to do life the way he would do apart from the will of the Father, but he came to carry out the will of the Heavenly Father. And that is the very principle of the cross.
Amen.
There is a crucifixion of self-will.
Yes.
We don't govern our own life and try to tack Jesus on where it seems as though he can fit a little. But instead, there is that denial of ourself, the death to ourself, and it has to be a day-by-day thing. That's why Paul would say in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, "I die daily." I have to be reckoning the crucifix of the Lord to be a reality in my life every day. And I enter into the dynamic of the cross every day. I die daily.
Amen.
That's the testimony of a disciple. Paul wrote in Galatians chapter 2, verse 20, "I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but it is Christ
who lives." Amen.
I am crucified with Christ. Paul says, I do have a cross. And I enter into that crucifixion in partnership with the Lord Jesus Christ. I ask you this morning, have you given an unreserved, unconditional surrender of yourself unto the Lord? That's what you were called to at the time of your salvation experience. An unconditional, unreserved surrender of yourself. Again, that's what it means to confess Jesus as Lord. If you will confess the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved.
Amen.
Confessing the Lord Jesus. Acknowledging the authority of Jesus. In other words, I have no claim over my life. Jesus has claim over me.
Yes, Lord.
And my days are to be lived with the claim of God over my life. And then secondly, as I think about the cross, I think about the cross of Jesus, and I think about the parallel with our experience as being his followers. We follow him in the pattern of the cross. Not only is there that repentance from a self-governed life, but there is rejection of world conformity.
Amen.
Rejection of world conformity. As Jesus was before Governor Pilate awaiting his sentence for execution, as we find it given in John chapter 18, we find that Jesus makes these words, "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would fight so that I wouldn't be handed over to the Jews. As it is, my kingdom does not have its origin here." But yet so many Christians act like this is it. We live for this life and this world and this moment and the pleasures of this world. When we talk about the world, not only do we talk about this physical world that we live in, the physical realm that we live in. No doubt Jesus is certainly speaking greatly about the fact of a physical world and his servants who would come to his defense in this physical world. But there's also clearly here a disconnect from the philosophies and the values that of this world that has resulted and been the product of the fall of man into sin. The blindness of the soul and the contamination of the heart that has produced all of the various values and the worldview that so characterizes ungodliness in this world. And the Bible tells us that as a disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ, we follow Him and we do not follow the ways of this world.
Amen.
Conformity to this world is not the way that we live. Do not be conformed to this world, the Bible says in Romans chapter 12 and verse 2. 1 John chapter 2, verses 15 through 17, the Bible says, do not love the world. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man will love the world, the love of the Father is not in him.
Amen.
Because all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes and the pride of life, they are not of the Father, but they are of the world.
Amen.
The world passes away and the lust thereof, but he that does the will of God abides forever. You don't abide forever because you do the will of God, but you do the will of God because you are those who are going to abide forever.
Amen.
We live a life of obedience because we have been redeemed unto the Lord. And we are to live that life that demonstrates our recognition of His authority, His lordship. What a powerful statement the Apostle Paul made in Galatians chapter 6, verse 14, where he said, God forbid that I should boast. But as for me, I will never boast about anything except the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now get this, through whom the world has been crucified to me and I to the world.
Amen.
And so by the power of the cross, those who have been saved, those who are disciples of Jesus, we have died to the world and the world has died to us.
Amen.
I'm talking about control. Doesn't mean that we're not influenced by the world and that we don't ever sin because we live here in an environment that is so affected by the world. But it's just not our heart. This world is not our heart. Oh, we understand the plight and the ruin of swimming in the waters of this world. We recognize that. And finally, not only is it repentance of a self-governed life and the rejection of world conformity, but it is a resolve of obedience.
Yes, Lord.
It's a resolve to a life of obedience. What do you see when you look at the cross? I mean, just go there in your mind. What do you see when you look at the cross? Well, you see the holiness of God when you look at the cross. You see what God thinks about sin. You see a great conflict between God and sin when you look at the cross. What do you see when you look at the cross? You see the love of God. God demonstrated His love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for the likes of you and me. That's love. That's love. What do you see when you look at the cross? You see the grace of God. You see God's grace. God giving to us this life that we don't deserve. We see the mercy of God and that God has stayed His hand of wrath and judgment against us because Jesus took our place.
Amen.
And He experienced the judgment and the wrath of God for us. What do we see when we look at the cross? We see the depravity of our heart. We see the sinfulness of our soul. We see how terrible it is because our sin is so bad that the only way God could bring us into an eternal relationship with Him is that His own Son had to die.
Amen.
At the cross. You talk about how bad our sin is. You look at the cross and you'll see how terrible our sin is. What do we see when we look at the cross? We see the ultimate act of obedience. I mean, there's never been an act of obedience greater than the act of obedience that you see being carried out at the cross. The cross is about obedience.
Amen.
Obedience tested to an immeasurable level.
Amen.
That's what you see in the cross. When Jesus was dying on the cross, He was dying there for our sin, yes. When Jesus was dying on the cross, he was dying there in obedience to the will of the Father.
Amen.
Philippians 2:8 says he humbled himself by becoming obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. The cross was Jesus' greatest act of obedience. Romans 6, verses 17 and 18 says, but God be thanked that you were the servants of sin, but you have obeyed. You've obeyed the gospel. You have obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine which was delivered to you. And having been now set free from sin, you became slaves of righteousness.
Amen.
And so a disciple of Jesus is a slave of righteousness. We are a slave of the Lord. The Lord is our master. This morning in my office, I had the wonderful privilege of having one of our children, our church, and family there with me, and shared the gospel with this child, and this child prayed to receive Christ as their Savior. He'll be baptized next Sunday with the others who will be baptized. And as we prayed, and this little fellow, I was leading him, of course, in prayer, and we prayed for the Lord Jesus, save me and be my boss. That's what it means to be a Christian as Lord. Save me and be my boss.
Yes, Lord.
Oh, how precious. Have you ever asked the Lord to be your boss? Or did you just ask Him to help you be a Baptist? have you ever really asked Him to be your boss? And mean it? Lord, I put myself, I present myself as a living sacrifice before You, and I want You to rule and reign over me. That's where discipleship begins. That's where it begins. The cross. The cross is repentance of a self-governed, self-directed life. It's rejecting the world's pressure. And it is a commitment to obedience, this life that God has caused. That's the cross of discipleship. Jesus said, make no mistake. If you're going to follow me, you've got to deny yourself and take up your cross daily and follow me. Otherwise, you cannot.
Amen.
You cannot be my disciple. You might get all kinds of recognitions and applause. And you might get all kinds of pins for attendance and all of that. You might get your name up in lights, in the neon lights of Christendom. And Jesus said, you can't follow me without a cross. If you don't know the cross reality in your life, this morning you need it. And I urge you.
Yes, Lord.
I urge you to pick up the cross. Pick up the cross. The cross, when the scriptures written, cross in the context of Jesus' word, were known as the ancient Roman means of the electric chair. You pick up the cross, you're saying, I die so that the Lord, the life you have me live, can come into reality. I die so Christ can live through me. Let's stand in prayer.